My name is Alex Tucker. I'm the Special Projects Coordinator for the Ralph J. Bunche Center for African American Studies. I'd like to thank all of you for coming out for our first event of the year. This is the Bunche Center Author Series, of which we have a few throughout the academic year where we try to promote the research of our faculty and friends in the African-American diaspora. Today we're pleased to have Caroline A. Streeter. Caroline Streeter is Associate Professor of English at UCLA here. She's affiliated with the Ralph J. Bunche Center for African American Studies. She teaches interdisciplinary courses in literature, film, visual art, and popular culture. Today we're going to discuss her latest book, Tragedy, Mixed Race Women and the Nexus of Sex and Celebrity. And it examines popular representations of biracial women and of black and white descent in the United States, while focusing on novels, television, music, and film. Without further ado, I'm proud to present Professor Caroline A. Streeter. Let's give her a round of applause.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Alex. It's so nice to see people here, so many friendly faces. Thank you for coming out. I'll just talk a moment about what my book is about, and then I'm going to go on to discuss the fifth chapter, which is a chapter on Halle Berry and Dorothy Dandridge. I won't be able to read all of the chapter, and I'll probably kind of read around a little bit. So if, and I want to leave a little time for us to discuss. I want to leave at least 10 minutes. Okay, so the year, actually, let me just ask, the sound man, can you bring the Dandridge up so we can see Dandridge, a portrait of her? Yeah, that's great. Okay. Now, Alex actually asked me to talk a little bit about how long it's taken me to write this book, and I'm not going to reveal that. But I will say that I've been interested in mixed race in the United States, mixed race of black and white descent in our history and in our culture for many years. And this book is the culmination of what I began in graduate school as my thesis. So it is a project that's very dear to my heart, and poured a lot of blood, sweat, and tears into it. And it's just a slim little book, you know, it's under 200 pages, notes included, and it's a nice little read. I recommend it. The year 2008's historic spectacle of an African-American man and a white woman running for president illuminates the ways in which the nation still contends with the difficult unfinished business of a society configured through structural inequalities of race and gender. During the protracted primary campaigns of Barack Obama and Hillary Rodham Clinton, many aspects of public discourse became consumed by the troubling history of white, black, interracial sexuality and the charged politics of black, white, mixed race identity. Tragic No More takes up the compulsive attention to racial boundaries in the United States and explores why female figures are so often the visual representation of race mixing. This book is a multidisciplinary study of women on the color line, black, white women, and their role in the simultaneous creation and undoing of racial categories. I analyze black, white femininity through fictional characters in selected novels and television, as well as through examples of biracial women in music and film who achieved celebrity status in the 1990s and after. Now, I also include a chapter on the biracial celebrity concert pianist Philippa Schuyler. And the arc of the book actually goes from the present to the past, because my theorization of the mulatto figure is that the mulatto figure ruptures linear time. So what we see in the case of race is that race, and especially racism, are continually morphing to accommodate new historical conditions. So that is why it doesn't really make sense, I don't think, to talk about a linear progress from better, from worse to better, or better to worse. And that's why when I'm going to talk about Halle Berry and Dorothy Dandridge as examples of figures that work together in the present and in the past. But I should say that the two analytic categories that I've used to look at mixed race, black, white mixed race in the United States, are the two narratives of, on the one hand, the historical narrative of the creation of the mulatto in slavery, and that traumatic history of racial inequality, and especially the sexual transgression of racial boundaries, the transgression of racial boundaries through violence, and the use of the one-drop rule to actually make mixed-race people, mulattoes, part of the black community. So with regard to the African-American community, that one-drop rule has been adopted and becomes a source of racial identity. The other discourse we have begins after 1967, after the last laws against interracial marriage were declared null and void by federal law, in which we start to see the development of a mixed race community that's not just black and white, but that begins to be constructed by people of all different kinds of ethnicities. And particularly in the case of mixed race, I would say we have immigration, you know, we have the growth of Asian American and Latino American communities, so that the face of mixed race is international, you know, it's global, and someone like President Obama is an exemplary figure representing that diasporic mixed race. But what I argue is black, white, mixed race, and the mulatto are still representative of race mixing in the United States in a way that is odd, because if you look at the statistics with regard to who would identify as multiracial in the census, people of with any kind of black descent are the least likely to identify as anything but black. So there's a history to that, but those are the sort of two analytic poles that I talk about. And this chapter on Dorothy Dandridge and Halle Berry it looks at an example of black-white women who cross that line between what is considered mixed race and what is considered black or light-skinned black. So Halle Berry is herself the daughter of two black, you know, people, mother and father, although her father was said to be very light-skinned, and her grandmother, his mother, was said to be indistinguishable from a white woman. Halle, and of course she was born in 1930, or maybe the late 1920s. She was 41 when she died in 61, so that means the 1920s. So her experience is that, right? That experience of being classified as black. Halle Berry is a biracial woman with a white mother and a black father who has the experience of the example of the post-loving generation, what we call the first post-loving generation. Okay, and what I'm arguing is what is necessary for the formation of a black screen goddess in the case of Halle Berry, because Halle Berry is considered to be Dorothy Dandridge's artistic heir and the person who was able to fulfill finally her ambitions. Wrenching tales of racism and sexism in Hollywood engender poignant examples of thwarted potential for film actors. Such is the case with Dorothy Dandridge, who at mid-century stood at an artistic tipping point in Hollywood. In 1955, Dandridge became the first woman of color nominated for an Academy Award, Best Actress. Her role in Otto Preminger's film Carmen Jones positioned her to become a genuine leading lady. The nomination gave Dandridge international acclaim, but could not compensate for the very few roles available for black women in dramatic leads. Even when Dandridge was cast, industry production codes and cultural mores prohibiting miscegenation limited her opportunities. Island in the Sun, which was her second major feature, it emerged in 1957, titillated the audience with interracial love, but downplayed Dandridge's erotic appeal. The film could not be screened in Southern theaters without key scenes between Dandridge and her white film lover, played by Michael Rennie, being cut. Throughout her lifetime, Dandridge was forced to supplement her income with nightclub engagements. And ultimately, her role in Carmen Jones was the pinnacle of her film career, and the combination of professional and personal disappointments led to depression, a reliance on prescription drugs, and her death in 1965, when she was just 41 years old. So Dandridge's life was unprecedented because she seemed poised to enter the rigidly segregated realm of film goddesses. More than simply a role model, Dandridge is a citational figure, a cultural symbol that not only inspires widespread personal identification, especially among black actresses, but also facilitates the articulation of ongoing struggles over representation. This conversation was revived in 2001 when Halle Berry became the first woman of color to receive an Academy Award, as I'm sure you all know, for the film Monsters Ball. In her emotional acceptance speech, Berry claimed her award as a triumph for Dorothy Dandridge. Now, just in case everyone here isn't familiar with the figure of the tragic mulatto is that historical figure, especially thought of as a white-looking black woman who, but for the drop of black blood in her veins, would be able to achieve anything a white woman could. So Dorothy Dandridge's tragedy, I argue, becomes Halle Berry's triumph. The positioning of Halle Berry as Dorothy Dandridge's artistic heir credits her with fulfilling the promise of Dandridge's career. This notion became naturalized in media discourse leading up to and following the Academy Awards ceremony, so much so that a linear trajectory between Dandridge and Berry is likely to persist as a feature of Hollywood film history. The celebration of these women as symbolic milestones and the incorporation of their careers into a narrative of racial progress laid the groundwork for an irresistible construct. Hollywood can make amends for Dandridge, its tragic victim, by anointing Berry as an exemplary and representative African-American actress. The figure of the black white woman provides the traction for this narrative in the late 20th century new millennium. The 1990s revised representation of the tragic mulatto converges with the extra diegetic context of the public's awareness of Halle Berry's biracial heritage to contextualize the idea that Berry is the logical heir to Dandridge. Halle Berry represents what her cinematic ancestor might have achieved under different historical circumstances. The cinematic trajectory from Dorothy Dandridge to Halle Berry reveals how miscegenation went from unspeakable taboo to a lucrative site of commodification in the late 20th century. The potent hybrid bodies of black-white women trigger the specter of miscegenation in ways that remain compatible with the values of a rehabilitated multicultural America. That both Dandridge and Berry are defined as African American reflects a continuity in how blackness is defined in American culture, as well as conventional casting in cinema. During her lifetime, Dandridge's blackness derived from the institutional enforcement of the One Drop Rule. The criminalization of interracial sex in marriage, along with racial segregation, repressed the evidence of race mixture in the larger society by confining it to black communities. Although Dandridge was a potent sex symbol for film audiences, to cast her opposite white men violated film production codes and the era's social conventions regarding interracial sexuality. So if you look at the film production codes of the era, which came out in the 1930s, the Hays Code, one of the primary things that they prohibited was depiction of miscegenation. So you can see then that actually Ruby Dee said something about this some years ago. I heard her say that she felt that American cinema had failed because cinema is so powerful and can convey messages that can teach people things, right? And many people, I know now from teaching my classes that especially younger people are very responsive to the visual, right? To the story told in the visual. So the thing about banning miscegenation in film is that it not only removed it, but it also reinforced the idea that this was not normal, this was not natural. But not only that, but the depiction of even intra-racial African-American sexuality was also taboo. So in the case of Carmen Jones, which starred Dorothy Dandridge and Harry Belafonte, two very sexy people, as Jet Magazine said in praise of that movie, movie makers are now casting a Negro couple as a love team that does not tax the imagination. So the idea of black sexuality is about black sexuality in and of itself and how miscegenation also becomes black sexuality. So the One Drop Rule extends to everything involving sex, basically. This is the argument. Okay, so by the 1990s and 2000s, depictions of interracial sexuality constitute titillating taboos that move products and attract audiences to films like Monsters Ball. Born in 1968, Halle Berry, as I said, is the child of an interracial couple, part of this biracial boom generation. And although her biracial heritage is well known among film audiences, she represents miscegenation as this titillation, no longer illegal, but still carrying a hint of the forbidden, no longer regulated by production code restrictions, but still relatively rare and often controversial. In other words, miscegenation works for Berry. It facilitates her career as much as it may also mirror her for options. The fact that she inspires the potent desire associated with interracial sex does not diminish her utility as a positive hybrid, an effective bridging figure between the races. All right, now I'm going to talk a little bit about the film that Dorothy Dandridge both starred in and produced called Introducing Dorothy Dandridge. It was an HBO production, and she won a Golden Globe for Best Actress and Best Producer. Along with savvy career strategy and fortuitous timing, physical appearance is crucial to the apparent logic of Halle Berry's identification with Dorothy Dandridge. Berry established a concrete link between herself and the late actress. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you this clip that has still images of Dorothy Dandridge while the song, her song, I Got Rhythm, plays. And then I'm going to show you a clip of Halle Berry in introducing Dorothy Dandridge performing the same song. I'll just say, in terms of setting up the clip, that Dorothy Dandridge has been in her dressing room with her manager, and the manager is trying to gently say, well, you're going to have to stay in a hotel that's outside town, and I think it's a good idea if we enter the club where you're performing through the back. And she says, look, don't sugarcoat it. I'm a Negro. I know what this life is like. And then she says, come on and zip me up, and then I'll go to the bathroom. And he shows her a styrofoam cup and says, this is your bathroom. And he tells her, you told me not to sugarcoat it. So then she comes out on stage, and this is Halle Berry performing the same song.
Good evening. I'm Dorothy Dandridge. Was there I for fortune or fame? They never mattered a lot. I don't have a right to complain. Long as I've got what I've got.
That Dorothy Dandridge actually incorporated into her performances. She was able to make her living primarily as a singer in these segregated clubs. And this was something that she really despised. She hated having to go out there and be basically a sexual object, basically use her sexual allure rather than being the dramatic actress that she wanted to be. So you can see there how she was kind of trapped between these imperatives on the one hand, and you can see here too, what film is as a genre, as opposed to what these segregated clubs were giving as entertainment to these white audiences. So Dorothy Dandridge represented too much alluring sexuality to be a dramatic actress, but her alluring sexuality was her commodity in the club scene. Along with savvy career strategy and fortuitous timing, Introducing Dorothy Dandridge faithfully recreated the conundrum of physical appearance for Dandridge, who, while celebrated for her mulatto beauty, found that few Hollywood films could accommodate her racially ambiguous looks. Now here, Dorothy Dandridge, her mother, Ruby Dandridge, was actually a large, dark-skinned black woman along the lines of Hattie McDaniel, I'm forgetting the woman who starred in Imitation of Life, but women who, as some people say, represent the mammy figure, and were often contrasted with these light-skinned black women who were their granddaughters, for example. So that's the case in the movie Pinky, where Ethel Waters plays the grandmother, and I don't remember her now, a white actress plays the granddaughter, who's passing, who's the tragic mulatto. There was also a famous stage play called, Mamba's Daughters. Yes, Mamba's Daughters, where, again, Ethel Waters played a grandmother figure, large, dark-skinned, and Freddie Washington played her either daughter or granddaughter. And it played on Broadway. It was very successful. And the word was, you've got to go to this play where this light-skinned Negro, they say she's a Negro, but she looks white. So that contrast in black female femininity and that way in which there's this establishment of two polar opposites, the not quite white, seductive mulatto beauty, and the dark-skinned, larger black woman who is an asexual figure, as you all know. Okay, so as I said, film roles for black women tended to split along the color line, and, here they are. Hattie McDaniel, Louise Beavers, that's the one I was thinking about for the film Imitation of Life, and her own mother, Ruby Dandridge. For Dorothy Dandridge and Halle Berry, viability as Hollywood stars derives from mulatto beauty, an appearance that is equated with refinement and sophistication. Mm-hmm. These qualities are crucial for a black leading lady to succeed as a simulacrum for the white screen goddess. Yet the screen goddess must also strike a fine balance between respectability and eroticism. For black women, this is much harder to achieve, given the historical equation of black female sexuality with a lack of virtue. The privilege of light skin tone, then, is double-edged, and Dandridge herself showed herself to be painfully aware of this paradox. In one of the biographies of her, the one by Donald Bogle, she has said to have commented about her nightclub career, Ella Fitzgerald is one of the most talented people in the world, and it embarrasses me that she cannot work the rooms that I work. The reason is so horrible. She's not sexy. The men in the audience don't want to take her home and go to bed. And she's up there singing her heart out for one-third of the money they're paying me. And I resent being in that category. So clearly for Dandridge, the monetary award she derived from being in demand on the nightclub circuit did not compensate for being this erotic object for white men. The successful commodification of black-white women in visual culture turns on the transformation of mulatto glamour into an appealingly lascivious sexuality. In effect, mulatto beauty facilitates the jettisoning of bourgeois class status and sexual propriety. And Dorothy Dandridge, I think, her comment really succinctly captures that what is in fact a trick, right? It's a trick about being a mulatto and having privilege, but a privilege that quickly becomes a kind of liability. Let's see. Oh, okay. So there is a scene in introducing Dorothy Dandridge that recreates her interview with Otto Preminger when she auditioned for the role of Carmen. And apparently, and this is in Donald Bogle's biography as well, apparently she went to his office with her agent and, you know, dressed in a suit like a lady to say, I would like to audition for this role. And apparently, apparently Otto Preminger said, you're very sophisticated, you're the epitome of high fashion. But this role of Carmen is one of an earthy girl that's entirely different than you are. Every time I see you, I see Fifth Avenue. Subsequently, in introducing Dorothy Dandridge, she convinces Preminger to change his mind. And what's interesting here is that there is a scene between Dorothy Dandridge and her sister Vivian Dandridge in the film, and Vivian Dandridge was also herself an actress, where Vivian Dandridge hears about this interview that didn't go well, and she says, go back there and be sexy. So Dorothy Dandridge goes back dressed as Carmen, and Preminger explains it is Carmen, right? And he casts her. Porgy and Bess was Dorothy Dandridge's second ill-fated film with Otto Preminger. Now, the reason that Porgy and Bess was a failure has to do, or let's see, it's a really complicated story. If you have searched for Porgy and Bess, you may know that it is a virtually impossible film to find. And it is said that because Sidney Poitier had to play a man who was handicapped, he actually went around literally on his knees. He was on a kind of like a skateboard because he was handicapped. And so it is said that Sidney Poitier has bought the rights to Porgy and Bess, so it'll never be seen again. But Porgy and Bess depicted Dorothy Dandridge played Bess, a prostitute. And in the reviews of the film, some reviewers said Dorothy Dandridge is not convincing as a prostitute because she's too ladylike. She has the mulatto look of a refined lady. So can you play that clip of just for a few minutes of Porgy and Bess so I can show you the play? This is good enough. This is good because this takes less time. So, yeah, just if you could, if you could just make it large so we can see the photograph, that's perfect. So here she is playing the role of Bess. And if you ever get a chance to see the movie, you can order it as a very poor quality DVD. And you'll see that in the film, Dorothy Dandridge is definitely contrasted with the other women in the movie, who are all dark and who, because they are, I guess, virtuous wives and mothers, they dress as Gershwin imagined them, which is their heads are covered and their skirts are long, and Dorothy Dandridge has a skirt with a slit and she's got a knife, you know, and she's a gambler and so on. So this is the image, though, that some film critics found unconvincing. All right. Now, I'm going to skip ahead so that we have a little time. Let me see. Oh, yes, okay. All right, so can I have that clip of Monster's Ball, please? Okay, so we just have the still, right? We're not gonna, okay, yeah, because I don't really wanna say it. Yes, so this is the role for which, of course, as you know, Halle Berry won the Academy Award, and film criticism and media coverage of Monster's Ball routinely marveled at the decision to cast Berry as the unfortunate Letitia, tirelessly reporting the director Mark Forster's declaration that Berry had to be very persistent to convince him that she could depict a working class, down on her luck Black woman. This commentary accelerated after the announcement of the Oscar nomination when, for example, Vanity Fair magazine's Hollywood issue of 2002 featured Berry under the heading The Surprise. Notwithstanding the familiar stereotypes that cast aspersions on a beautiful woman's intelligence, the Dizzy Blonde, for instance, used to characterize Marilyn Monroe, does it make sense to contend that a transcendent beauty would impede acting ability? In fact, Hollywood requires A-list actresses, often, to negotiate a complicated double standard with regard to the requisite beauty of a screen goddess and the acting ability of an exemplary artist. Does it behoove a woman to prove that she can act without the so-called crutch of beauty? As more varied roles proliferated for women in cinema, numerous female stars have garnered acclaim for playing actors. Gosh, I'm so sorry. Numerous female stars have garnered acclaim for playing characters requiring them to minimize their good looks, passing in ways that de-emphasize their beauty and feminine allure. So examples include Hilary Swank becoming a man in Boys Don't Cry. She also played the plain featured Maggie Fitzgerald in Million Dollar Baby. Gwyneth Paltrow became a man in Shakespeare in Love. And Charlize Theron did the, you know, ultimate sacrifice of gaining weight and wore dental prosthetics to pass as the downright unattractive serial killer Eileen Wuornos in Monster. And in another role that received significant attention, although it didn't earn an Academy Award, Nicole Kidman donned a prosthetic nose to play Virginia Woolf in The Hours. So would such a strategy work for Halle Berry? The possibility seems unlikely, for beauty and sexuality, whether high class or wanton, are so enmeshed with the Black-white figure as to be inextricable from what makes her a successful icon. The power of this discourse demonstrates how very narrow a platform exists for Berry to launch her bid for the status of screen goddess. The Black-white woman's ability to convincingly portray Black characters requires a metaphorical darkening of the skin, achieved by enacting downward class mobility and a convincing transformation that is enacted through sexuality. So, some of you may have seen, that actually refers to something else. So, so the mechanism explains, so the torrid sexual encounter, which I have been forced to, you know, put on the screen, this graphically sexual scene was a crucial turning point in both visual and narrative terms, constituting the climax, as it were, of what I see as the film's exploitation of Berry's physical beauty and a solid foundation of arousing misogynist sex for the subsequent development of the film as an interracial love story. So my critique of Monster's Ball, see, I can recite this by heart, is that Halle Berry's mulatto character is actually depicted very explicitly in between white and black in this film. So you see that she's surrounded by black people in a community where no one seems to know her. In fact, Mos Def, you know, who has the two sons and is a young, good-looking guy, doesn't seem to know who Leticia is, which is completely unrealistic, right? That would never happen. But also, Leticia has to depend on this white prison guard to be taken care of, quote unquote, right? Now, what makes the character so troubling is not so much this actual sex scene. You know, this is a turning point narratively, and of course, it became, right, very deservingly, the scene that proved her acting ability, right? I'll just let that sink in. Sink in for a moment, right? But with regard to the way the story resolves, Billy Bob Thornton apparently falls in love with her, right? It's an interracial love story. But just as the mulatto of history, the white man of history, the mulatto of history, he doesn't have to offer her marriage in order to take care of her. At no point does marriage come up. He puts a fresh coat of white paint on his walls, he moves her in, and at the end, you know, and there's the white tombstones of his mother and his father and his son in the backyard, and at the end, they're sitting on the back porch together, and they're looking up at the black sky punctuated with white stars. So it's a really common way in which, in contemporary narratives, the interracial love story actually relies on the eroticism of miscegenation, right? In order to pique our interest and in order to successfully commodify what is then transformed into, you know, the rehabilitation of a racist, right? So, and as I say about Monster's Ball, you know, the Monster's Ball is the last meal of a prisoner on death row, and it's Halle Berry's husband, as you know, who has his Monster's Ball with the prison. This prison guard is the one who sits with him, and the prisoner, who's played by Sean Combs, he draws his portrait, right? And all the portraits go to Halle Berry's son, who conveniently dies, by the way. You know, it's like we can't start a movie without killing a black body. We need a dead black body to begin, right? And then Sisu says, we need a dead woman's body to begin. But when Halle Berry finds this portrait of her husband, and she crumples it up and she decides to conceal it, that's her Monster's Ball. That's her annihilation. That's how I read the film. So then, just to quickly finish up, as the narrative of racial progress was well served in the Academy Award ceremony of 2002, where Halle Berry won her Academy Award. At the Academy Awards Oscar night of 2003, we had a different kind of narrative about Halle Berry. The master of ceremonies, Steve Martin, made a lewd reference to Halle Berry near the beginning of the broadcast, joking that she has had him served with a restraining order. And subsequently, while introducing Berry to bestow that year's Best Actor Award, Martin paraphrased her statement of the previous year regarding how honored she felt to be the woman who broke down this door tonight for African-American actresses, women of color, paving the way for other women of color. Martin declared Berry responsible for breaking down the door for really hot women in Hollywood. Mm-hmm. Barry then took the stage to announce Adrian Brody as the winner, in after which we got the notorious, you know, mauling of Halle Berry by Adrian Brody. So my last, the way I conclude this chapter is by asking, do sexual jokes and thinly veiled mauling come with the territory of being a black-leaning lady? Simply put, black-white women's sexuality conjoins white and black femininity in such a way as to guarantee perpetual desirability and availability. As the current preeminent representation of that fetishized body, Halle Berry reaps the benefits and suffers the consequences. Unlike Dorothy Dandridge, Berry benefits from the aura of miscegenation. It can be openly commodified in late 20th century and early millennial visual culture. Fortunately, though, for those of us who continue to be traumatized by Monster's Ball, popular culture's continual cycle of citation can respond and challenge this status quo. For example, at the MTV Video Awards of 2003, Adrian Brody and Queen Latifah presented the award for Best On-Screen Kiss. As they prepared to announce the winner, Latifah grabbed Brody for a passionate embrace, a clear reference to the mauling kiss, and Latifah put a period on the kiss by slapping Brody on the backside, declaring, "This is for you, Halle." So we have just about 10 minutes for some questions, and we can certainly, for those of you who want to stay a little bit, I can also stay. And I'm happy to have comments as well, or questions about the book as a whole. Yes?
I'm actually really curious as to what artists you focus on in the music.
Mariah Carey and Alicia Keys. Yeah. The messed up mulatto, Mariah Carey. And the mulatto who identifies as that, identifying with the one drop rule. Although I think that, again, you know, the situation of them as polar opposites is misleading. But yeah, that's it. Yes.
Can you bring your argument, solidify your argument with people? Because you said my argument is.
Yes. So actually, I didn't. I'm sorry, because I didn't actually flesh out for you the two milestones that I start and end with. So, as I said, with regard to the nexus of sex and celebrity, or mixed race biracial women, or actually mixed race women who are biracial and black white women. What I mean by the nexus of sex and celebrity is that the black white woman is virtually, I argue, always a figure who materializes these questions of sex that show that more than the virgin whore dynamic, we could look at it that way, but more than the virgin whore dynamic, it's really about the way in which racial identity and the visible manifestation of race play out in making her proximately white or visually black. So virtual whiteness versus visible blackness is one thing I'm working with the nexus of sex and celebrity. She also is that body who represents miscegenation and is continually poised to produce miscegenation, right? Regardless of who she would reproduce with. So she's that kind of, I think, like a subject zero for this coming together of trauma and transcendence with regard to how mixed race is supposed to function in our culture. But with regard to the idea that the mulatto ruptures linear time, because that's an important part of it too, I begin with the example of Essie Mae Washington Williams, the biracial illegitimate daughter of Strom Thurmond, who announced her existence in 2003, just after Thurmond died, and has the proto-mulatto experience of slavery, right? The daughter of, the disavowed, disinherited daughter of a powerful white man from the South, the black domestic who was 16 years old when Essie Mae Washington was born, and also also when she emerged in the public eye, the way in which the news media narrativized the story was to make it clear that Strom Thurmond wasn't a rapist. So the question was always, do you think your parents loved each other? And she would say, well, I think there was affection, but I never asked. And so then, kind of like the prison guard in a way, right? He gets rehabilitated as someone who was a creature of his time, but fulfilled some kind of responsibility by actually giving her money, which in her memoir she describes at one point as hush money. So she is that example occurring in 2003. I end the book actually with the example of Philippa Schuyler, who was a biracial concert pianist. She was born in 1931, she died in 1967, coincidentally, just weeks before Loving versus Virginia outlawed all the miscegenation laws. But she was the daughter of a very famous black journalist, George Schuyler, and his white wife, Josephine Caudill. And she became basically a figure of the black diaspora because she was a child prodigy in New York, like the little adorable Philippa Schuyler, the Negro Shirley Temple, that's one word that was used for her, or one phrase. And subsequently, when she became an adult, she then could no longer be that child prodigy, then the color line in classical music prevented her from becoming, you know, an artist or a working artist in the United States. However, she became a very famous figure in the black diaspora, kind of like almost an ambassador, because she performed for heads of state all over the world. In the chapter I wrote on her, I look specifically at the two racialized public cultures, black public culture and the white public culture, that represented her, by which I mean the newspapers. So when she was alive, there were many, many black newspapers. You know, major cities had two or three. You know, they existed all over the country, as many of you know. And the way that the Schuylers were talked about in the newspapers was as this progressive family. You know, and black newspapers wrote articles like, does interracial marriage work? You know, it seems to work. And because the laws against miscegenation were basically an argument supporting white supremacy. And that's exactly what the Warren Court said when they struck it down. They basically said two things. They said, the law has no right to interfere in private life. And they also said, preventing marriage between white people and black people is implicitly saying that black people are inferior. So with regard to Philippa Schuyler, the family, she represented this kind of eugenic example on the one hand, but also the family represented this kind of odd, they were kind of odd and kooky, but they were also a classic trio of a very dark man, a very light woman, and this beautiful cinnamon-colored child with liquid dark eyes. So by looking at those two points, what I want to say is that this idea of the post loving family, you know, is actually something that occurred in the past and was the in many ways, because there was a Black public culture, it was the subject of a lot of interesting public discourse. Whereas with Essie Mae Washington Williams, we have a proto-slavery example, but we also have it smoothed out in the mainstream media. So that's also the nexus between sex and celebrity, is also about, again, how the mixed race woman becomes this focus for what mixed race means in American culture and why mixed race women are seen as, again, you know, that manifestation of interracial sex and also that perpetual reproducer. Yes?
I was wondering the use of the term black-white woman, because of the tragic history of slavery, most African-American women are black-white. So is the focus of your book only African women who are visibly black-white? For instance, in Danzy Senna's book, you know, there are two sisters.
Danzy Senna's book,
so
yes.
So you'll be focusing on the one who could pass, as opposed to the blacker, the blacker sister.
Yes. What I would say is that calling them, I actually, throughout the book, I call them different things. I say black-white, mulatto, women of color, and it, depending on the historical period. But yeah, I call them black-white because I want to show that there's an overlap between actual biracial heritage and the kind of blackness and whiteness that derives from a mixed African-American community. But that, you know, there's this on the one hand, there is this splitting, right? On the one hand, there's this splitting about what it means to have a biracial identity. On the other hand, the continuum is also there. So in the example of Dorothy Dandridge and Halle Berry, for example, you have a so-called black woman and you have a so-called biracial woman who are, in fact, located on a similar continuum, and a continuum that is about blood and that is about identity, but it's also about the visual, like you said. So you know, the two poles are really, when it comes to the representation of the women, it's virtual whiteness and visible blackness. That's what I would call it. Does that answer the question? Yeah.
So does that mean that you're privileging the black women who look white?
Even though
most African American women are biracial, you're looking mostly at the women who are visibly biracial.
Well, so when you say most African American women are biracial, you mean most African American women are actually of
racial
mixed
heritage.
Race.
Right.
Because
of the history.
Right.
With the master and so forth.
Exactly. So I am definitely looking at the way that this certain kind of mixed race woman who is visibly mixed race resonates with the mulatto of American history. Yeah. Other questions? Another question?
So I'm really interested, you probably don't get into this in your book, but what your thoughts were about this kind of single point biraciality, like there's no legacy really, and then if, say, there is a black white woman who goes on to marry or have kids with another black man, and then
yeah,
their children aren't really biracial anymore, like,
right,
where does that, I don't know, how do you think about that kind of points of...
That's a really great question, and I think that for me, that speaks to actually the eugenic question, because Professor King Hock Chung said, there is, on the one hand, you know, if you look at the definition of mulatto in the dictionary. There are two definitions, right? The race mixture among in the black race and a person of black descent and white descent. So that overlap is there, right? So for example, when you say you have a black white woman who has children with a black man, in Louisiana, we would have, you know, done the taxonomy of, you know, 1/16th, 1/8th, and so on and so forth, right? But I think that when it comes to a mulatto, right, I think that, you know, well, as you probably know as well, a mulatto is Spanish for the sterile hybrid, right, of a donkey and a horse, I think. So I think that in a kind of imaginary way, mulatto is actually meant to be the end point, right? It's like it's got an expiration date. And I think that that's about, you know, some kind of, I don't know, you know, I'm still kind of working on this idea, but that idea of the sterile hybrid